You're on. Okay. So, so let's roll. So the bracha of Baruch Aleinu, as we often do, we just, you know, start off with the comments of the tour, when he explains some of the, you know, the ramazim that are the earth in that bracha and how the bracha was designed. So the tour points out something very interesting where he notes that there are 30 words. Remember this whole sheet that we had in the name of the Chachmei Ashkenaz to explain that all the words are measured in each one of the brachas of the Shmoneh Esrei. So he pointed there are 30 words that are there in the bracha of a Baruch Aleinu. And he notes that the Chachmei Ashkenaz note that the Torah quotes the remez there is based on two very, very famous psukim that are there in the Torah that describe for us the bracha parnasa that the Ribbono Shel Olam gives for us. So one pasuk begins with the words of pasuk in Devarim Perek Kaf Ches, begins with the words Yiftach Hashem Lecha Otzara Hatoves Hashemayim. Hakadosh Baruch Hu promises that He's going to open up for us His Otzara Hatoves Hashemayim. He's going to open up His storehouses in Shemayim to shower down all the different kinds of shefa and bracha that person needs. And that particular bracha is 23 words, that particular pasuk rather, I should say, that Avtacha has 23 words in it. And then you have the famous pasuk of Poseach Yesodecha Mezbilachol Chai Ratzon, which is another very, very well-known tefillah about the parnasa that the Ribbono Shel Olam is going to give and take care of us. And that has seven words in it. So the combination of the two, the Torah says, brings out in the name of the Chachmei Ashkenaz is the number 30 that we have in that particular bracha to remind us of the fact that Lamaisa, all of the parnasa that the Ribbono Shel Olam gives, all of that kind of bracha, are things that are well accounted for in the Torah. But if you look at the two psukim that the Torah quotes, I think you see that there's a very interesting lesson and a message that's there. And it's not just random, as always with these ideas that they quote. They're not just a random. You know, number game, a name, number word game, you know, random number game that's there. So, for example, the first pasuk that he quotes, Yiftach Lecha Hashem Esotzara Toves Hashemayim, sounds like it's a Havtacha. The Ribbono Shel Olam says to us, he's going to open up the Otzaros and Shemayim and take care of whatever it is that a person needs. Mitzad Sheni, and on the other hand, the second pasuk, right, that's the, you know, it's building into the 30-word bracha, is a pasuk of Poseach Es Yodecho Mezbilachol Chai Ratzon, which is obviously a bakasha, on our part that HaKadosh Baruch Hu should open up his hand and Mezbilachol Chai Ratzon and be Mezbiyah and just satiate everything that everybody wants in this world. So there's two sides of a coin that are there in that bracha for reading carefully. On the one hand, there's the Havtacha that the Ribbono Shel Olam gives, that where he says that I'm going to take care of you. Yiftach L'Hashem L'chas Otzara Tov. On the other hand, the bracha is meramis to us, the tzorech of tefillah, that the fact that there's a bracha that HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives, Yiftach L'Hashem Otzara Tov, that's on the one hand the guarantee of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but the way we access that particular bracha is through the medium of tefillah, of asking the Ribbono Shel Olam, of Poseach Es Yodecha, U'Mezbilachol Chai Ratzon. Let's remind ourselves of a comment that Rashi makes in Parshas Bereishis, where if you look, the pasuk reads that Rashi quotes a Chazal to this effect and explains a series of two psukim that are back to back. So it says that all of the vegetation that's out there in the field, before it actually was able to grow properly, because the pasuk explains that Adam ayin la'avodes adama, there was still not yet an Adam who was there la'avodes adama, who was there to work the land. And Rashi quotes, and I'm paraphrasing the Rashi, incorporating a parish of the Gur Ariyeh on Rashi also, the Gur Ari of the Maral. So this is a combination of it, really the Pashup Shad and Rashi, but the Gur Ari spells it out very, very clearly and beautifully as follows. Then it says, explains Rashi and the Gur Ari that it's true, HaKadosh Baruch Hu set up a world where he wanted everything in the world to be good for people. He wanted the world to be a place of a near unlimited amount of bracha. That's a famous, you know, Chazal that's quoted by the Ibn Ezra at the beginning of Chumash, that Bereshis, at the very first word of the Torah about the creation of the world, was the base to indicate that the very creation of the world was meant to be able to bestow bracha on people, the benevolent, ultimate good. Ribbono Shel, the Tov of HaMeitiv, just wants to be able to be Meitiv, wants to give good, wants to give bracha, and so on and so forth. And the world is a place where we're supposed to be able to access all of that bounty of the Ribbono Shel. However, when it says that Adam Ayin Lavodes Adama, that before Adam HaRishon was created, and there was no one Lavodes Adama, there's no one to work the land, Rashi says, and that pasuk again, along with the parish of the Gur Aryeh, that Rashi explained that Adam HaRishon wasn't yet created to be mispalil for Geshem. And because of that, the Rashi describes in Chumash, the vegetation during the first, you know, period when it was created, was able to pop up a little bit from the ground, but not able to sprout the way it was supposed to. Because even though the Ribbono Shel Olam put into the world all of that bracha that was there, but until there's someone to be mispalil, until there's somebody to come in and dive in to the Ribbono Shel Olam to access all of the tova, all of the bracha, and all of the good that the Ribbono Shel Olam wants to give, so he's not gonna give that. The lashon that the Maharal uses is that Ein HaKadosh Baruch Hu, HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't give bracha until someone recognizes that that bracha is actually coming from the Ribbono Shel Olam. So when the world is created itself, right, we have that idea that HaKadosh Baruch Hu put all of the goodness that was there into the world, but nothing yet sprouted, the fruits weren't growing, the all the different plants and other things weren't fully developing the way they were supposed to, until Adam HaRishon was able to come and be mispal and say, wow, Ribbono Shel Olam, thank you for everything, and please make sure to give us as much as you want, which is one of the keys of the way the world works, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is expecting us to recognize, there's a Borei Olam, there's a creator to this world who has an infinite amount of things that he can give to us, but we have to recognize that and then tap in with the different brachos and tefillos into those ideas. So I think that the pshat behind this remez that the tour is bringing over here is built into the bracha Baruch Aleinu, the bracha Parnasa, is that idea. There's a pasuk that speaks about Yiftach Hashem Lecha Sotzara Tov, HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, I'm going to open up the storehouses and be able to give you anything and everything you could ever want in this world. That's the first 23 words of the pasuk. The last of the bracha, the last seven words correspond to the pasuk of Poseach Es Yodecha. That's the bakasha that a person makes to Ribbono Shel Olam to give us that bracha. So even though Kadosh Baruch Hu says, yeah, I'm promising that it's going to be there, but until we come along and actually are mevakesh, and every bakasha, every time that we ask the Ribbono Shel Olam for something, built into that bakasha is a recognition that I understand that you're the one that this all comes from, you're the one that's giving it to us. And then with that proper recognition, a person is able to you know, turn to his world or parnasa and understand things, you know, in context of what it's all about, and where it's coming and where it's actually coming from. Everyone's reminded of the famous Journeys song, and if you haven't heard it yet, you should definitely listen to it. But you can decide if you want to wait till after Svira or not. There's a Journey song called "The Rebbe of Lublin," a very beautiful song. Where if you've heard it before, then I'm not going to sing it, I'm not going to play it for you, but. The basic idea of the song was that there was a gabbai and a shamish who was getting like annoyed that whoever the Rebbe of Lublin exactly was, that he would sit down at his table and say a little tefillah to the Ribbono Shel Olam that said, you know, I know that you give me my food and da 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 da. And the way the setup was, when as soon as he was done with his little, you know, tefillah, the gabbai waiter, whatever it was, would put the, you know, plate of food down in front of the Rebbe. The gabbai was getting a little frustrated and said, like, what do you mean? Like, I I'm bringing in the food every single day. What's this whole like frustrating tefillah that, God, you're giving me all the stuff that I have. I'm cooking in the kitchen. I'm putting it down on the table, etc. So the gabbai comes up with this ingenious plan, as only good gabbaim can do. And he says, you know what? One day I'm just like, I'm not going to cook the food and I'm not going to bring it to the table. And I'm going to show him that, like, that this is really coming from me. And not from anybody else, and stop with the whole tefillah thing, to Hashem. Like, I'm the one who's putting the stuff down on the table. So the guy says, I'm not gonna make the meal today. I'm not gonna serve it. And the Rebbe will finish up with his tefillah. Thank you, God, for giving all the things to eat. And there's not gonna be any food on the table. a greater plan. So that's what he does. As the Rebbe is sitting there, saying that tefillah that day, not realizing that in 2 seconds there's not going to be any food, coming out to the table, because the gabe, has sabotaged the whole idea. So there's a knock on the door, and the Rebbe goes to answer the door, and there's somebody standing outside saying, Rebbe, I came to say thank you. We had X, Y, and Z problem in our family. We came, X amount of time ago to ask for a bracha and this and that. And you gave us a bracha, and it really came true, and we're so excited. So as a way to say thank you, here you go. I'm bringing you this whole, tray of food and like some, takeout, something, catering, whatever it was that I want to, contribute to, to the Rebbe to enjoy as a token of thanks. And then the Gabbai who saw this taking place realized, he really showed me, I decided today's the day that I'm not putting out the food, I'm not serving. And Adarabba, the Ribbono Shel Olam worked it out in Hashgacha Pratis that he ended up, having the guy knock on the door and bring that, particular gift to Davka today. And again, there's always that idea that's there, that a person understands on the one hand that, the bracha is just, coming from the Ribbono Shel Olam. But on the other hand, like the schus that we have to be able to access all of that bracha is through the tefillah. So those are the two psukim that the Torah brings over here that are the number, the 30 word bracha is based on. Again, that's a little pshat that we're saying in terms of what the significance of those two psukim that are joined together in this bracha are meant to represent. Moving along. We notice there's also one very other interesting but also very, very important thing that's there. So if you ever look in the Mishnayos and Masechta Tainis, you'll notice that the Mishnayos speak about two expressions that we use that both have to do with the tefillos we say for rain. Okay? There's a something that we call the bakasha, and there's something that's called the she'ela. So we with she'ela bebirkas hashanim. We ask for rain in the Birkas Hashanah, in Baruch Aleinu. Very much along the same ideas like we were just speaking about. The word she'ela in Lashon HaKodesh, if we understand Hebrew, when I'm sho'el, yesh li she'ela, a she'ela, right, is always something that I'm asking from somebody else, right? I have a question I'm asking, from you. There's a sho'el and a nish'al, the asker and the askee. The word bakasha in Lashon HaKodesh doesn't necessarily mean that I'm asking you for something, but there's something that I'm mevakesh, or things that I search after, things that I want, things that I things that I need, like the pasuk in Chumash about Yosef Esachai Anochi mevakesh. So we can also say that there are bakashos that people ask, but the etzem word bakasha doesn't necessarily mean that I'm asking another person. It's just something that I'm looking for. The lashon that Chazal use when they speak about the idea that we ask for rain, like v'sein talamata the bracha, is a we're shoel. There's a she'ela for geshamim, and part of the idea behind that is exactly the idea that we're speaking about is the significance of a person learning how to align himself. That yeah, if I want to be zochet to things here in this world, I have to realize that I have to be standing in front of the Ribbono Shel Olam and Davka asking the Ribbono Shel Olam for whatever it is. Something that I'm going to be in need of. There's a very, very famous passage in the Chovos HaLevavos, and then we'll start with the going through some of the text of the bracha. But the Chovos HaLevavos says something fascinating. He says that we know that the Torah tells us that we're always supposed to be making a what we call hishtadlus here in this world, based on a pasuk be'erachticha b'chol asher ta'aseh. I'm going to give you a bracha on everything that you do. And the Chazal understand from that pasuk b'chol asher ta'aseh that we have to have an asiya, we have to do things here at Olam Hazeh. We have to have a hashtadlus. You have to go to school, you have to get a job, and so on and so forth. Basic concepts of hashtadlus. Says the Chovos HaLevavos, something that's actually very, very difficult to do. He asked a question that many of the Mefarshim grapple with, and there's more than one explanation. We're just going to highlight the approach of the Chovos HaLevavos now. But the question is a very basic question, like what exactly is the point of the hishtadlus if we know that everything we get is all like hashgacha pratis from the Ribbono Shel Olam, he's going to give us things. There was a gezar din that he made on Rosh Hashanah, what we're going to receive for the year. So does it really matter if I put in a you know, a 14-hour workday today, work really hard and try really hard to do X, Y, and Z, the Ribbono Shel Olam goes there, whatever is going to be. So let me just kick back and relax, and who really cares? Should I really bother going through the 12 years of med school and specializing and this and that? Who cares? The Ribbono Shel Olam wants me to have X amount of, you know, of salary for that year, so I'll get it. And, but what's the point of bothering going to school? A question that many of the Rishonim actually, you know, talk about. What's the balance between the idea of Hashgacha Pratis and the Gezar Din that a Kadosh Baruch Hu makes on Rosh Hashanah and the Hishtadlus that a person does? Says the Chovetz Halevavos something very, very interesting. He writes that the challenge of the Hishtadlus is that a person has to be Mishtadil. You have to be putting in the effort, right? All the different natural means that we have at our disposal to reach whatever, you know, let's say parnasa, accomplishment, the goal that we have. And all the while the person's engaged in that hishtadlus, the Chovetz Halevavos says he has to have a 100% emunah that his hishtadlus is doing absolutely nothing. In other words, he says there's a dichotomy. I have a chiyuv in the Torah, right, to make the hishtadlus, right? But part of that chiyuv is there to train us to understand that all of the maisim that a person is doing with himself are not really what's bringing the bracha and the parnasa. Ultimately, that's coming from the Ribbono Shel Olam, right? But I have to understand that there's a tevedic way of doing things, but ultimately that's not where it's at. Where it's really at, right, is the fact that the person is, like we're saying, is being a mevakech or shoel from the Ribbono Shel Olam. Understand that, yes, he wants to give us all that parnasa, like we were beginning with. He wants to give us all the bracha. But we have a responsibility to be becoming a legitimate clay kibble, receptacles for that particular bracha. So hishtadlus is one of the ways that HaKadosh Baruch Hu has. And one of the other things that we're expected to do is use the medium of tefillah, which is what this particular bracha is all about, to be makir betov from the Ribbono Shel Olam, to recognize that he's where it's all coming from, and to be mispalel, a heartfelt, you know, tefillah for the different brachos that we're hoping that the Ribbono Shel Olam is going to be providing. We notice over here that the bracha of Baruch Aleinu is the last of the brachos that deals with the individual bakashos that we have during the Shemona Esrei. Right? After we move it to Kabbashov for Gadol Chirusein, which speaks about in the Rambam's Lashon, the first parak of Hilchot Tefillah, the Tzarchi Atzibur Kulam. But this is the last of the brachos in the personal section of the Eli Bekashos on the Shemona Esrei. And if you remember, we were discussing the Gemara's Megillah, Daf Yud Zayin, where the Gemara speaks about the idea that all of the brachos are in a seder. They all go in an order, right? And the order of the things that a person actually needs in this world. So we started, you know, months ago with the bracha of Atachon and the Adam Das and the significance of intellect and using our minds, here in this world, how that was the key to everything and anything else that comes about in our life. And what's interesting over here is Dafka, that the last bracha, meaning the least important thing and lowest on the totem pole that a person is going to be asking for, is the bracha of Parnassa. Right, and there's once again a very, very important lesson, right? Almost as important as we spoke about when we were trying to emphasize why Atachon in the Olam Das is the first bracha and how significant Das and intellect is. Here, what we're being taught is just the opposite. On the totem pole of allowing a person to live a life with a lot of quality, with a lot of meaning, a lot of purpose, and to fulfill his tachlis and tafkid in this world, the actual amount of physical bracha that the person has and parnasa is not the make it or break it of his life. But even if that's, you know, not, again, lo aleinu, but even if that's not totally there and the person is struggling for parnasa, that doesn't mean that a person at all can't have a very, very meaningful and significant elevated kind of a life or a lifestyle. Adarabba, the parnasa is helpful certainly to do certain things, but in terms of the significance and the importance, what I'm put here in this world, the brachos that we're davening for in Baruch Aleinu are definitely not the most important thing, that are there on that list. And that's why when we spoke about tefillah as being like an act of avodas Hashem, and how we learn how to really plug in to all of the hashkafa and the musar that Chazal want us to have, This is a very, very important bracha, right? Because we all know that so many people in the world spend their entire life focused on the topics that are discussed in the bracha Baruch Aleinu, and they totally forget about all the things that are discussed in the previous brachas. And here, the Chazal are coming and telling us, no, that's actually totally, totally messed up. This is the end of the totem pole, or I can say that it's the bottom of the totem pole, that's the expression. Bottom of the totem pole, least important thing, that's there's certainly helpful, it's certainly like easier in a lot of ways when that's there, but that's not what's important, that's not what's gonna enable a person to actually be able to fulfill their tafkid and tachlis in their life. So that's an introduction to the, like we said, to part of the idea behind the bracha, the inherent bracha that's there versus the tefillah that we have to access that bracha, the role of tefillah as a part of hishtadlus that we have to misfalo to access bracha, and then the idea of the placement of the bracha as the last of the things on the list of the personal bakashos that are there. Interestingly enough, it's actually Berenice and Eibishitz and his sitter brings a very interesting twist, and there's this not exactly in line of what everything else we're speaking about in the introduction now, but still something that's very, very significant. Rabbi Yonatan Eibishitz says something interesting, that aside from the fact that this bracha is a bracha of parnasa in general, it says Rabbi Yonatan Eibishitz that the bracha is also meant to help us focus on my today's brachos and my today's parnasa and my today's enjoyment of Gashmias as well. And says the Rabbi Yonatan Eibishitz, he brings in the name of Moshe Cordovero, the Ramak that you met in Tzfat a couple of weeks ago. He says that the Ramak was makbid not to do anything letzorech achila, not to prepare a meal, not to put something on the fire, not to do anything food-oriented until he would daven shachris in the morning, because he felt that the entire involvement in all of today's meals and all of today's food and all of today's gashmias should only be after I've already like focused myself in terms of my my kavana and understanding that this is all coming from the Ribono Shel Olam. So that was a very interesting, again, I'm not recommending everyone do that necessarily, but certainly a very interesting outlook on understanding that like these things actually matter, and the way we approach our life in gashmias and our parnasa things really should be always within the context of the tefilos that the person is being mispalo. So let's take a little look now at some of the, like I said, some of the inyanim that are here in the bracha. We have over here as follows, that the bracha begins Baruch Aleinu Hashem Elokeinu Hashana Hazos Yes Kol Minei Sfuasa LeTova. So we ask the Kaddish Baruch Hu to give a bracha to this year, right? Yes Kol Minei Sfuasa LeTova, and all of the tevua, all of the produce should be LeTova, should be good as well. So Kolim Kol, let's point out that the first part of that bracha, Baruch Aleinu Hashem Elokeinu Es Hashana Hazos, has a little bit of a hashkafa question that's there, because we know that the Mishnah points in Rosh Hashanah that the Ribono Shel Olam is Dan the entire world, Kobani Adam over in the front of Kibani Maron. We passed in front of the Ribono Shel Olam on Rosh Hashanah. He decides what our everything about us on Rosh Hashanah, which includes our parnasa and all of the sustenance a person is going to get. So why is it that throughout the year a person is constantly, going to be, davening Baruch Aleinu Es Hashana Hazos? There was already a gezar din that was made already from the time of Rosh Hashanah. Okay, so the different svarim point out, a couple of ideas that were meant to be thinking about. Of course, right, one of the ideas that's very basic that's there is that we know that there's a koach that tefillah has, and that tefillah a rabbim has, when a person is davening b'tzibur, or davening on behalf of a rabbim, to change a gezar din. So the bracha that we're davening on a daily basis, Baruch Aleinu Hashem Elokeinu Hashana Hazos, is saying, I know, Ribono Shel Olam, that there was a gezer that you made min hashamayim on Rosh Hashanah time. But regardless of what that particular Gezar Din was, Lamaisa, we have the ability to change the Ratfilos, the Ratshuva, to change things to be actually, you know, what we would perceive as a bracha for us here in this world. When we ask HaKadosh Baruch Hu as Kol Minei Sivuasa, the Tova, we ask the Ribono Shel Olam to bless the Tavua, the produce that grows for good. This is a very interesting comment in the Sidra Agra. They point out that an abundance of peros, an abundance of tavua, is not automatically a given that there's going to be a bracha. You might have a lot of like stuff that's growing out there, in the fields. But at the same time, if there's some kind of either massive inflation that's there, makes it hard to be able to get and buy. So you might have got a lot of stuff, but if it's not easy for me to get and make use of, that's not really so great. And at the same time, you can have a total deflation. It can have a total crash on the market. You can have lots of good stuff that's growing out in the field, but it's sort of worthless. So the Sidra Gra explains that the idea is Kol Minei Sivuasa. The Tova means we want the exact balance between the amount of produce, the amount of things that are brought into the world, with the in terms of the way the economics are going to work, that the prices should be the way that they're going to be beneficial for people. The farmers should make their money. We shouldn't have to spend too much money on the things that we're buying. So there should be the right amount of stuff. And the tova part, the good part of that relationship to the stuff is how exactly we're going to be able to access that. Either wanting to avoid either one of the extremes, too much inflation, we have to pay too much, or too much of a crash where the farmers lose out. Let everything be the tova. Like, I'm running a little late, so we're going to rush quickly over here. One of the controversial points in the bracha, we ask HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Sabeinu mituva, right? And if you look in the bracha, that line is a little bit interesting. I'm just going to read the whole thing over so we catch what's intriguing over here. Baruch Haleinu Hashem Elokeinu Hashanah Hazos, so I give a bracha to this year, right? That's in terms of time, like we described before, the Gezar Din that the Ribono Shel Olam made on Rosh Hashanah, had to make sure that things are still going good for us. As Kol Minei Sivuasa L'Tova, we want the Tavua, its Tavua from this year, should be benched L'Tova, like we just explained. Saying Bracha, or saying Talumato the Bracha, Al Pinei HaAdama, give Bracha to the Adama. The Pashup Shat, all of the Mepharshim say, is that the word Adama here is a reference to Eretz Yisrael. Sabeinu mituva, satiate us mituva from its goodness. Okay, and here we have a debate. The Rush, and one of his shuas in Cloud Dalet, the Rush brings down that he feels that this is not the correct nusach of the bracha. He says, "I'm not davening sabeinu mituva, satiate us from it, Eretz Yisrael's goodness, but it should be sabeinu mituvecha." Like, you, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, be masbiya. You, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, satiate us and give us whatever it is that we need. And that's why the Rush says he wanted to change many of the Sidurim had, is Sabeinu mituvecha, and not Sabeinu mituva, that we're speaking to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, not about the Eretz Yisrael. And I'm sure you've noticed, depending on the Siddur that you use, I don't know what exactly you guys say when you're davening, but there are two different Nuschos, two different Yersos, about that particular line. The Gra, and the Shulchan Aruch and Simon Reish Mem Aleph, when he speaks about this bracha, says Adarav, the correct version of the bracha, Sabeinu mituva, referring to Eretz Yisrael. And like we said, the Rush, very, very strongly felt that that wasn't the case. And people do different things. Probably the pshat behind the nusach of the Gra, which again is the nusach found in many early Rishonim. Gra didn't make it up. The Gra just said that he felt that was the right nusach to use. Has a very, very beautiful pshat in it. Also, why do we dive in Sabeinu mituva, satiate us from it, Eretz Yisrael's goodness? What's the point of that bracha? What's the point of such a tefillah? So the pshat behind the Gra, is a very, very important and very famous idea that's quoted by the Bach. The Bach is found in Siman Reish Ches in Orach Chaim. The Bach brings like this. There's one of the issues that the Rush brings up. There's another question about the nusach of the bracha of Alam Michya. Okay? Now, if you remember, Alam Michya is a paraphrase of the brachas in Benching. And one of the lines that we say in the Alam Michya is we ask Hashem to bring us back to Eretz Yisrael, lecho mipurya, that we should be able to eat the peros of Eretz Yisrael, v'lizboa mituvah, we should be satiated from its goodness. Okay? Now, the tour there in Simen Reish Ches, in Orach Chaim, brings in the name of the Rush, same Rush, who says that's also not the right nusach of the Alam Michya. Why do I daven lizboa mituvah? I ask Hashem to bring me back to Eretz Yisrael, to be saveya, to be satiated from its goodness. That's what I want Eretz Yisrael for, that I should be, you know, satiated and full from eating peros that grow in Eretz Yisrael. That's like the biggest deal in the world. You want to go back to Eretz Yisrael? You want karbanos? You want mitzvahs? You want a beis hamikdash? Kibbutz galios? The geula? Why are we davening? We want Eretz Yisrael. So, you know, lecho mipurya, he's brought me to it, eat the fruits and be full. Sounds like a funny thing. So the Bach on that simon in Orach Chaim in Reish Ches, the Bach has a beautiful pshat. The Bach says, it's mamash fascinating. Says the Bach that the kedusha of Eretz Yisrael. Okay, I'm looking at Shul Blachman's Israeli flag over there. The kedusha of Eretz Yisrael is such that the very land of Eretz Yisrael, the Adama, which is what we're mentioning in this bracha, is totally permeated with the kedusha of the Shechina. And there's a hashras Shechina everywhere in Eretz Yisrael, to the degree the Bach says that when a person eats from the peros ha'aretz, when a person eats from the fruits that grow, the produce that grows in Eretz Yisrael, there the Bach says they're ingesting, they're eating and taking into themselves the Shechina HaKadosha itself. And the person is bringing in a kedusha into his existence, like by the mere fact that he's consuming the peros of Eretz Yisrael. And says the Bach, which is an obvious thing, there's nowhere else in the world that you could have such a phenomena where even the Gashmi is so totally full and permeated with such an intensity of Ruchnius and Shechina. Says the Bach, that's what Eretz Yisrael is all about, and that's what we're davening for in that bracha. According to the Gra, it's the same idea when it comes to the Tefillah of Baruch Aleinu. Sabeinu mituva. We ask the Ribbono Shel Olam to satiate us with the goodness of Eretz Yisrael, because we understand that the peros ha'aretz are things that have a tremendous amount of kedusha, to keep us living a physical life that totally, totally filled with kedusha. There's a Meshech Chachma points out in Parashas Ekev. We're almost done. Meshech Chachma points out in Parashas Ekev. If you look, every time we bench in Birkas HaMazon, one of the chiyuvim de'orais of benching is to thank Hashem in the bracha of Nodeh Lecha for the gift of Eretz Yisrael. So the Meshech Chachma, says, why is that a chiyuv as part of Birkas HaMazon, to thank Hashem for Eretz Yisrael? Birkas HaMazon, bracha about food. So I'm sitting there, I'm looking out the thing, sitting in Boca, Chicago, San Diego, New York, wherever we are, someplace in Jersey, Atlanta, wherever I am right now, Detroit, we got them all. I'm just spread out over here. So if I'm sitting there wherever I am, and I'm eating whatever it is that I'm eating, I should be thanking Kadosh Baruch Hu for the food that I'm eating. Well, why in the world do I need to make a point of thanking Hashem for Eretz Yisrael? Explain to Meshech Chachma, when the Ribbono Shel Olam sends down a bracha into this world, all the brachas are all given over here to Eretz Yisrael first. And then, again, these are all spiritual concepts. And then they're divvied out after they are touched by the Kedusha Sa'aretz. All the brachas are divvied out to everywhere else in the world. And it says the Meshech Chachma, when a person's eating his deli sandwich somewhere on Central Avenue, wherever it is exactly that you eat over there, when the person's eating his sandwich, all of that bracha, all of the great stuff he has, is all a result of the bracha that was given through and funneled through Eretz Yisrael. That's the idea behind this bracha here. I'm davening for my parnasa, wherever I might be in the world. But we ask the Ribbono Shel Olam, Sabeinu mituva, we want to be satiated with the goodness of it, of Eretz Yisrael, because that's mashpia on everything and anything that goes on throughout the entire world. Of course, the other nusach is, the way the Rush says it, right, is that we're speaking straight to the Ribbono Shel Olam, Sabeinu mituvecha, right? The Ribbono Shel Olam, you take care of me, and I want everything to be, you know, totally filled with your goodness, a recognition, appreciation of all the Tova that you, the Ribbono Shel Olam, are giving us. One last line there, we'll be done. Baruch Shem Aseinu We ask HaKadosh Baruch Hu, give us a bracha like the good year. So that sounds like, again, if you're a cynic, it sounds like one of these like old people kind of things to say. The good old days, back in the days. Give me bracha just like those Shanim HaTovos, like the good old years that I used to have. And of course, on a Pasha level, right, we don't really know like what are those Shanim HaTovos that we're referring to. Like which Shanim HaTovos are we asking? Kadosh Baruch Hu to give us bracha just like them. So perhaps one of the pshatim should be there's a Gemara. It's actually a Mishnah, but it appears at the end of Masechta Sotah Daf Mem Ches, where the Gemara speaks about from the time of the Churban Beis Hamikdash. The Mishnah says there's been a lot of klala that's existed in the world. Nital tama peiros, nital shumana peiros. Foods and fruits are not as fat and rich and good as they used to be. Tara, Batla, Tam, Vareach. The Gemara has a whole list of things that have ceased from the world from the times of the Churban HaBayis. Again, for another shiur, maybe we could speak of why the existence of the Beis HaMikdash has such an effect on food and fruits and produce. But Lamais, that's what Chazal tells us, something to realize, right? How much we're missing from the world. Perhaps the bracha, Varech Shanasino, Kasharim HaTovos, right, it's coming along and telling us, oh, there was a time back when we had a Beis HaMikdash that the tevua and the teiros that we had unbelievable bracha. They were mamish the way they're really supposed to be, with a full amount of tam and reyach and shuman and so on and so forth. But we're missing all that because we don't have a Beis HaMikdash. So included in this bracha is a reference to the request that the world should go back to the time and place where we actually be able to have a real full experience of all the gashmistic brachas that the Ribono Shel Olam wants to give us. So those are some ideas behind the bracha of Baruch Aleinu. Whatever exactly, we're thinking, like I said before, it's easy to be mechaven because these are things that, hit our pockets and they're not hard to relate to at all. But the Ma'aseh Be'ezer Hashem HaKadosh Baruch Hu should give us all those different brachas that are there with her own, proper good recognition. So that is...